our first city council meeting after our brief summer recess, and I'm going to go ahead and formally call the meeting to order and ask that you call the roll.
Councilmember Buchanan?
Here.
Councilmember Watts?
Here.
Councilmember Zimmerman?
Here.
Mayor Pro Tem Mosca?
Here.
Mayor Jaffe?
Here. And we're fortunate enough tonight to have a color guard presentation, and Mayor Pro Tem Joe Mosca will lead us in the pledge and moment of silence, so let's proceed with the color guard. Would everyone please stand?
Please rise. Please face the flag, hand over heart. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. On this, the sixth anniversary of 9/11, I'd like to take this moment of silence and dedicate it to the victims of 9/11 and the many families that were affected by 9/11. You will never forget. Thank you.
You may be seated. Thank you very much. Okay, we have two sets of minutes before us to review for June 12th and June 26th. And are there any corrections or changes to the minutes?
Madam Mayor, on the minutes of June 26, 2007, at line 98, it still refers to me as mayor, and I'm pretty sure I had given up that duty at that time, so it should refer to me as Councilmember Buchanan. Other than that, I have no other corrections.
Okay. Good catch.
I'll move the minutes as corrected by Councilmember Buchanan.
Second.
Okay. Moved and seconded. Any objection? All in favor, say aye.
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 Any opposed? Okay. So ordered. And now I'd like to get a motion to move forward with the agenda.
Move the agenda as presented.
Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Any opposed? Okay, we can proceed with business. I'd like to go around the table for announcements, but before I do that, all of you will notice that we have a new face sitting at the dais of our new city manager, Elaine Aguilar. And I hope all of you will get a chance to meet Elaine and welcome her. We did a little welcome at the right before the council meeting. And Elaine comes to us from the city of Glendale most immediately. She was there for 6 years, and she also worked with the city of La Puente. Has a lot of really good experience. I know it's been a long process. Finding the right person for this special community, we feel we found that person. I think you will agree when you get to know Elaine, and she brings a lot of strong financial background and a very warm personality to our community, both of which are critically needed. So please join me in welcoming her, and Elaine, would you like to comment, make any comments?
Thank you, Mayor Jaffe, and thank you, City Council. I'd just like to
say thank you to the community for welcoming me so warmly into your city. And I just look forward to a very long, very positive, and a good relationship working here for the city of Sierra Madre and working for each one of you. So thank you very much.
Great. And we're delighted to have you with us. And Elaine hit the ground running. She was working before she was before she had her first day on the job, so August 27th. So please come by and meet her, and you'll see her at lots of community events. So that said, I'm going to go ahead and go to my left. If Don, if you'd like to start with any announcements.
Okay. Friday the 14th. There will be a talk by Michelle Zach, Temperance to Townhood. It starts at 7:30 p.m., ends at 8:30 p.m. It's located in the Sierra Madre Public Library and is sponsored by the Sierra Madre Historic Preservation Society. Also, on the 15th, Saturday, there will be the Centennial Pancake Breakfast and Kiwanis 80th Birthday. The Sierra Madre Kiwanis Club will host its annual Pancake Breakfast fundraiser on Saturday, September 15th in Memorial Park from 7 a.m. to 11 a.m. There will be plenty of pancakes hot off the griddle, plus sausages, coffee, and orange juice served to hungry Sierra Madreans. The cost is only $5 per breakfast.
I've got three announcements. First, on September 27th, there's going to be an honors dinner at Alverna Villa. This is the Sierra Madre Honors Program. It's an exciting event, and it's the city's opportunity to recognize and honor the true treasures of Sierra Madre. That's Sierra Madre's volunteers, our city commissioners, and our employees. One of the awards that's going to be presented that evening is the George Maurer Lifetime Service Award. So if you have time, make sure you can be there on the 27th. Also on September 29th from 12 to 4 o'clock, there's going to be a search and social. The Sierra Madre Search and Rescue Team will conduct a series of rescue first aid demonstrations on the library grounds. There's going to be equipment displays, video presentations, information booths, a special section on child wilderness safety education, where you can learn what to do if you're lost in the great outdoors. And then finally, turning now to October, on October 6th on Saturday, there will be an Oktoberfest golf and tennis tournament. It's sponsored by Supervisor Michael Antonovich. It's going to benefit the YAC. It doesn't say where it's going to be. Does anybody know?
The golf is going to be at Eaton Canyon.
Okay.
And then also the tennis is, I think, over here.
And no previous experience required. Joe played last year, right? Your very first time.
That's yeah. Previous experience.
Yeah. Well, that's true. Touché.
The other thing that I wanted to mention real briefly, and I hope it's something that we'll be talking about this evening, is last week I received a number of phone calls from residents who I can only describe as being absolutely irate that city water was being used as a dust suppressant at the One Carter site. The irony was not...
That's our fire department.
The irony was not lost on me, and I'm sure it was not lost on the residents, since everyone in the community is being asked to conserve water at the same time that we are apparently selling it to facilitate the development of One Carter. So hopefully that's something that we can talk about tonight and clear the air. I know I have a number of questions, and I'm sure a number of people in the council chambers this evening would have some questions as well.
Okay, and then I have some announcements. I did manage to take most of August off, which was delightful. And but there are so many events coming up in September and October, and I hope everybody will check the city website to kind of get the specific dates, because we can't announce all of them. But most immediately, we have the Chamber Mixer coming up Thursday. It's going to be 5:30 to 7:30 at our Playhouse, Sierra Madre Playhouse, and I believe we'll even have some theatrical activity as well. So we'd encourage all the folks to join our businesses there. And the other one that I'm very excited about is that I'm going to pick and choose. There's a lot of things coming up, but the other one I'm really excited about is we're coming to the end of our centennial year, and we've got a lot of events planned, including the Kiwanis Breakfast on Saturday. But the one I'm really excited about is October 21st is our community picnic and grand finale of our centennial year. And Huell Hauser, who many of you have probably seen on public television, will be coming to town and be mayor for the day. And I will happily turn over my duties to him. We'll see what he does, you know, with it. But we're working on the agenda for the day. He's going to have a film crew with him. He has requested some locations he'd like to visit. We're planning a number of others. We'll be doing a ceremony in Memorial Park near the Veterans Wall, and the picnic will be up at the Mater de la Rosa retreat. So that's going to be a really fun day, and we're planning proclamations and, you know, all kinds of excitement. See if I can get the Sierra Madre City College Band to reorganize for this, and just, we've got, if any ideas are welcome. Tony is the Tony Buckner and Judy Webb Martin are the co-chairs of this, and please send them your ideas, your thoughts and ideas. The other very exciting, I'm going out into the future a little bit, but the other very exciting upcoming event is that we are going to get a congressional recognition for being an All-America City. And that's going to take place on October 23rd. It's going to be in Washington, D.C., and we're only allowed to send two people. And right now it looks like it'll be myself and Alyssa Weaver. So, but we're really delighted about that, and that will, you know, really give us some recognition among our own elected officials, whom we then go to with our hands out for money. So some recognition about, you know, the accomplishment of being an All-America City. So I'm really, that's going to be excellent. We've got a city council strategic planning session coming up that's going to be in the end of October. I encourage people to look that up on the website. We also, for anyone here who, I know I see a number of commissioners here in the audience, put on your calendar Friday, October 5th, 4 to 7. We promise to feed you. And we will be doing another workshop, as we did about 6 months ago, on the city strategic plan, the current status of it, and ideas for input to our new strategic planning process, which will take place at the end of October. And let's see, there's anything else I absolutely need to announce. I think those were the critical ones that I wanted to announce. And several of us recently came back from the League of California Cities Conference, which was excellent. And I also was a real reaffirmation for me of our selection of Elaine, because everywhere I went, people were running up to her and saying, "Elaine, it's so great to see you. I haven't seen you." So she obviously is very highly regarded in the field, and that was a good affirmation. But also, there was a tremendous number of workshops on global warming, greenhouse gases, what cities can do, you know, to reduce greenhouse gases, what cities can do to reduce their carbon footprint. We brought back a lot of good ideas that we'll be sharing in the future. But it was, as always, very extremely productive and useful. Probably my favorite part was former Governor Jerry Brown, now Attorney General, talking about all the things that when he was mayor of Oakland, he's one of the few people who's actually, you know, been pretty much in every level of elected office. I mean, and he was very humorous about poking fun at himself for all the things, the bills he signed as governor that he hated when he became mayor of Oakland. And saying, yeah, I, you know, was trying to redevelop the downtown of Oakland and get some new business in and new housing. And then I was told I couldn't do any of that because I owned property in downtown Oakland, which he bought, you know, trying to be part of the solution, not part of the problem. And he said, what idiot signed that bill? Oh, yeah, it was me. So it was, he was very self-deprecating and just really, I mean, it really told you a lot about when you're on a different level, you view the world differently. And the things that seemed like a great idea are no longer feel like a great idea. So with that, I'll turn to Joe.
Right. Well, I'd like to also welcome Elaine Aguilar, our new city manager. It seems like she's been here for a while already because we've been meeting and going to meetings and doing a lot together. So it seems odd to welcome you, but welcome. Welcome to our city. My office time, as usual, is Sunday this Sunday, 2 p.m. in Kirsten Court. Come on down if you have any questions. I'd love to talk with you. This past Saturday, I was able to go to the grand opening of Steamers with John Buchanan. It's a great coffee shop down here on the Boulevard, so if you haven't gone there yet, please do go there. We want to make sure that the businesses here in town stay in town and that they're thriving, and it's a great business, so do go down there. I also just wanted to mention about the Kiwanis pancake breakfast. I believe the money that they're raising is going to actually go to benefit the Goldberg Park. So that's another important reason beyond the support of Kiwanis. It's another important reason to go to that pancake breakfast. Plus, it's all you can eat. So if you're hungry on Saturday morning, come on down to that. League of California Cities. I also went to the League of California Cities annual conference up in Sacramento with some of our staff and with the mayor and with Councilman Buchanan. It was a very good time. We were able to talk with a lot of fellow council members and mayors from other cities, talk to them about some of the problems that their cities are facing. You know, you quickly learn that we're not alone, that every other city is facing the same issues that we're facing. So it's good to find out what they've done that's working for them and what they've done that's not working for them, so we don't have to repeat that same mistake. I was also able to go to a number of workshops that I think were extremely beneficial, and I have a list of things now for the staff to do when from coming back. But there was a workshop that on how to create more transparency between the government and the people, and I think that's particularly interesting, especially how technology works into that. How can we use technology to engage the public in, and also to make sure that they know what is going on and that we're listening and we're understanding what their opinions are on any number of issues. Also, public transit. We talked about there was a workshop on buses, rail lines, and the future of public transit, which was very interesting since I represent this city and a couple other cities on MTA. So that was very interesting. Also, talked about just updates on, we had that talk that Jerry, our attorney, general attorney, General Jerry Brown gave, which was very interesting because Governor Schwarzenegger signed a global warming bill, which is going to revolutionize the area of global warming in that it's a state of the art and most restrictive legislation to come out of any state. In fact, it's probably more restrictive than any other nation has on the books currently. That legislation essentially says that the state of California is going to reduce their CO2 output to the 1990 levels by the year 2015. And the Attorney General is talking about some of the things that he's been doing to make sure that we're getting ready to make sure that communities are complying with this. So it was very interesting. Also, we get an update on Prop 1C bond money, which is affordable housing money, which again was very interesting, especially from our point of view. And also the state of education. There was a very interesting talker presentation on education and talking about how we can better the education not only in public schools in California but around the country and how it's needed. Again, interesting since I sit on the represent the city on PUSD, Pasadena Unified School District. So that was a lot of good information. I think that was about it. That's everything I've attended in the last week or so. If you have any questions, come on down to my office time on Sunday, 2 p.m., Kirsten Court. Thank you. And if you want to call me, you can call me too, 836-8580.
This Thursday is the fourth meeting of the Ad Hoc Finance Committee, which is focusing particularly on how to fund certain public safety needs in the community. Attendance got a little better last time, although apparently that's because we thought the thing was being telecast live and it wasn't, so some people actually came down here rather than watching it on television. But we urge you to come and listen and support, because we're going to be taking this program out to people as well. This is really about the future of our city. It really is about whether we're going to have the services for so many of the kids in this town that I see sitting in the audience tonight, whether we're going to have our own police department and we're going to find the revenue to actually pay them what we think they is appropriate and that they deserve, and it's more than they're getting now. These issues don't go away, so we'd like you to pay attention to the Ad Hoc Finance Committee meeting that will be taking place this Thursday, and then we'll have to reshuffle the meeting at the end, but we hope to have some public meetings out away from City Hall as well. A lot of important issues. Kurt Zimmerman and I have been attending those meetings through August, even though we were on vacation technically, but very important. The League of Cities, I won't go back over all of this. Yes, climate change was the big issue, and I think there was such a big issue, and there were so many interesting things. I heard Lieutenant Governor Garamendi actually give a very interesting speech to the council member and mayor's section of the League of Cities, and made some interesting observations about how you need long-term incentives for alternative fuels, how transit will still be the biggest issue in dealing with global warming issues, and also indicated that there's at least one study that shows that reliance on fossil fuels over the not too distant time period will actually cause a 20% reduction in gross domestic product in this country. The cost of them, the rare, the scarcity of it, the reliance on them will actually be harmful to the overall economic outlook of this country. I think he's probably right. So I'm hoping at the end somebody will remind me that we should agendize an item to talk about how green is the city of Sierra Madre and how it can become greener still. Because one of the themes that permeated this entire conference was that sometimes the federal government don't act, so from the ground up, the cities will start acting. And one by one and across this country, we're going to make a difference in something that I happen to believe is very real in global warming. And I think we have an obligation to deal with that, and we have an obligation to deal with it even here in tiny Sierra Madre. There were other programs on grants and interesting things about the Homeland Security Appropriations Bill and the transportation bills in the city, but I'll talk to city staff about that. You should just know that we are looking hard for money, and these conferences help us in that regard. Also, one last thing, there will be one of the big issues that is up in front of the legislature but isn't getting a lot of attention is eminent domain reform. The League of Cities has proposed legislation that would protect various types of institutions, including single-family homes, small businesses, and churches, from eminent domain. That bill got a lot of support in the Senate, but because it was a constitutional bill, Senate and Assembly, but because it was a constitutional bill, it did not get the two-thirds requirement in the state legislature. The alternative that may be coming down the pike is looks like the son of Prop 90. And for those of us who remember the Prop 90 battle from this last election, this one won't be any better. It's being passed around for initiative purposes now and to be signed. I think we'll have something to say about it, but you should be aware that what somebody puts in front of you may not necessarily be what they tell you it is with respect to eminent domain reform. I would encourage you to think long and hard before you just sign something to get them out of your hair. But that's that from the League of Cities.
And I'll just add one thing on the League of Cities that was another item we were updated on, which is the telecommunications. I don't know if people have followed this. It's sort of arcane, difficult to follow. But essentially, the phone companies have convinced the FCC that they should not have to pay utility user tax, or is it franchise fee. And it's been in court. City of LA has been leading the charge, and it's not looking good for the cities. It's looking like they will win their case, and in which case we will lose yet another source of revenue to the city. If we do any sort of revenue measure, there are some ways, if we choose, to reword our ordinance to correct that. But in the near term, we're just another little chip taken away from our funding sources. So is something else that we need to keep an eye on. So. Okay, I'm going to go ahead and do, we have a number of, I'm sorry, Don? Yeah,
I just wanted to tell people that over the next couple of months, what happens in the ad hoc committee is very important to the community. And people should take an interest in it, because it really is going to make a great, it's really going to determine the town's future and who polices it and who takes care of us in terms of emergencies. So please take part. You have control over this. All we do is bring this out to you and present it to you. You can control the content of what we go forward with. We just will take those recommendations and put those in the form of an initiative. So again, I don't know how to stress this any more than I can, but this is very, very important.
Thank you. I'm going to go ahead and do, we have the presentations. We have a number of presentations tonight, some very important presentations, and I know a lot of you are here for those. And then we'll move on to public comment immediately after that. So our first presentation is recognition of Blake Anderson, Christopher Riboli, Stephen Riboli, and Brent Maglia, and police personnel Sergeant Keith Abbott and Officer John Ellens for saving a neighbor's house from fire on October 29th, 2006. And Chief, are you going to be doing that presentation?
I'd like to call to the podium the parents of Blake Anderson, Steve Riboli, and Christopher Riboli, please. Fine. Come on up. It's Cindy Riboli and Steve Riboli. They're here to accept the proclamation on behalf of their sons who are all away at school right now. Blake Anderson, Christopher Riboli, Stephen Riboli, and Brent Maglia. On behalf of Brent Maglia, Richard Maglia. Are you here by yourself? Okay. Also. Okay. On behalf of their son, Brent Maglia. Whereas on October 29th, 2006, at approximately 12:30 a.m., Blake Anderson, Christopher Riboli, Stephen Riboli, and Brent Maglia were in their neighborhood when they saw a large smoke plume in the area and found there was a large deck fire of the house on the house at 600 Auburn Avenue. And whereas the out-of-control fire continued to burn the dark structure, the deck structure, and was beginning to burn the house, Blake Anderson began using a garden hose and buckets to fight the fires. And whereas Blake Anderson, Christopher Riboli, Stephen Riboli, and Brent Maglia continued to assist with fighting the fire after the Sierra Madre Police Department personnel, Sergeants Keith Abbott and Officers John Ellens, would you come forward, please? Arrived on the scene in less than 2 minutes. And whereas Blake Anderson, Christopher Riboli, Stephen Riboli, and Brent Maglia, Sergeant Abbott and Officer John Ellens continued to quell the fire until the arrival of the Sierra Madre Fire Department. Now, therefore, let it be resolved on behalf of the people of the City of Sierra Madre, the City Council does hereby recognize the life-saving efforts of Blake Anderson, Christopher Riboli, Stephen Riboli, Brent Maglia, Sergeant Keith Abbott, and Officer John Ellens for their role in protecting the life and property of the residents of this community. Presented this 11th day of September, 2007, Mayor Ina Joffe, Mayor Pro Tem Joe Mnoska, Council Members John Buchanan, Don Watts, and Don Zimmerman. Excuse me, Kurt Zimmerman. Blake Anderson. Christopher Riboli, Stephen Riboli, Brett Meglia, Sergeant Abbott, Officer Ellens.
Thank you very much. That's exactly the kind of neighbor helping neighbor that we think of in our community, and people just going right ahead and jumping in when they're needed. So thank you again, and we're delighted to recognize you. We have a second presentation, and I see Fire Chief Lowe is here to do this presentation with Chief Diaz. And this is recognition of paramedic coordinator Greg Christmas and firefighter Michael Kefalas and police personnel Captain Larry Giannone, Sergeant Keith Abbott, and Desk Officer Jeanette Dabney for a life-saving event on May 18th, 2007. So why don't you go ahead and do the presentation?
Sure. Would those personnel please come forward? Before we describe this event, I'd like to call attention to the details and the firefighters. Yes, the details of this event. This event was particularly significant because it involves the saving of a four-year-old little girl. The little girl, Lily Bear, is present along with her parents. Shannon and Stan, would you bring Lily forward, please? Whereas on May 18th at 1:41 p.m., Desk Officer Jeanette Dabney received a 911 emergency call to the police personnel. Child not breathing. Mother states her four-year-old daughter was hanging from a swing set rope and was blue in the face. Whereas Desk Officer Jeanette Dabney calmed the panicked, screaming mother and elicited critical information about her from her from the tragic accident. Desk Officer Dabney transferred the concerned mother to Verdugo Fire Dispatch Center for the response of the Sierra Madre Fire Department. And whereas Desk Officer Dabney continued to monitor the emergency phone call and provided updated information to the responding police and fire personnel. Captain Larry Giannone and Sergeant Keith Abbott both arrived within a minute. Both checked the child, who was lifeless at the time, to render aid to the unresponsive girl. Captain Larry Giannone checked the vital signs and realized the girl was in grave condition after a tragic accident. At this time, paramedic coordinator Greg Christmas and firefighter Mike Kavalas arrived in the paramedic vehicle. Captain Giannone and paramedic coordinator Greg Christmas realized that this took the breaking of normal protocol. Captain Giannone drove the rescue ambulance to Arcadia Methodist Hospital, allowing fire department personnel to tend to Lily in the rear of the emergency vehicle. Sergeant Keith Abbott drove ahead of the rescue ambulance to provide updated information to the staff at the emergency room at Arcadia Methodist Hospital. When Lily arrived, she was in critical condition and was later transferred to Huntington Memorial Hospital. Fortunately, Lily made a complete recovery. Therefore, let it be resolved that on behalf of the people of the City of Sierra Madre, the City Council does hereby recognize the life-saving efforts of Desk Officer Jeanette Dabney, Captain Larry Giannone, Sergeant Keith Abbott, paramedic coordinator Greg Christmas, and firefighter Mike Kefalas for their rapid, effective response and attention to duty in protecting the life and property of residents of this community and ensuring public safety. presented this 11th day of September 2007, Marianna Joffe, Mayor Pro Tem Joe Mosca, Council Members John Buchanan, Don Watts, and Kurt Zimmerman.
I know that this is a very emotional presentation for everyone. Would anyone like to make any comments? Anyone, the honorees or family, like to say anything?
I'll do this without a microphone. And as you can all imagine, this is when you go through something like this. It's harrowing and terrifying and. Every parent can, if you haven't been through something like this, you can relate. And we just want to express our, just a profound debt of gratitude and thanks to everyone here and the emergency services, you know, in general here in this town. And this is, some of you who know us pretty well knew that this was right on the eve of us moving up to Oregon, and in fact our house was already in escrow and due to close in about 15 days, and it was, you know, unbelievable when just how things are orchestrated. And needless to say, we didn't move to Oregon, and we're so happy to be a part of such a great community of caring people. And you know, there's no way we could ever express how much we appreciate you all. Thank you.
Thank you very much, and that's the second happy ending to the story, that we get to keep you in the community. So that's wonderful. Okay, our last presentation, Chief Lowe has some announcements to make about years of service and recognitions.
Good evening, Assistant Chief Hyder. Can you come down and give me a hand? It's my pleasure to present to you a number of firefighters, both for being new firefighters and firefighters with a number of years of recognition. Their newest firefighter is a gentleman by the name of Eric Hopkins. Unfortunately, he could not be here tonight. We have four firefighters that will be given a five-year pin this evening. So with 5 years on board is Jason Brody, Mike Darrow, Rod Spears, and engineer Robin Wolinski. If you could come forward. Okay, great, there you go. Good. Thank you. Now, of significance is another gentleman on the department, paramedic firefighter Ryan Torrancilla, with 10 years. And with a great 15 years, we have Captain Chris Morrison. Woo! Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thanks to everyone. And I don't know if everyone has seen Roger's new recruiting poster for the volunteer fire department. He wants you. I think it's wonderful. I think we should put it all over town. I really enjoy that. So I used to have one of those posters in my college dorm room, but it didn't look quite like that.
I'm Roger. I don't know what's going on.
We won't go there, right? We have one other announcement, and for that I will turn to Michelle Keith.
Good evening. I'm very excited tonight to introduce to you the first goal off of your senior master plan gets checked off tonight. Susan Clifton has been hired on as the new recreation coordinator for senior services. Susan? So some of you may know Susan. She's a lifelong resident in town. She's also been very active in town. She spent the last 17 years working in the nonprofit sector for such organizations as the American Cancer Society, the American Red Cross, and Cerebral Palsy. She has extensive experience working with volunteers in recruiting and training them, as well as fundraising and program development. And we're very excited to have her on board, and more excited to see what's going to happen in senior services at the Senior Center.
Excellent.
Welcome, Susan.
Welcome.
Thank you.
And Susan, not to lay any heavy burden on you or anything, but improving senior services was one of my major goals for the year that I'm mayor. And we're absolutely delighted to see the completion of the senior master plan and see the position filled. And I know you'll do a great job, and we're really looking forward to being able to move ahead with improving our services and increasing our outreach to seniors. So thank you. So.
Translated meaning she's going to call you every day.
Right. Right. Now that I'm older. Right. So, okay. Moving along, I'm going to now go to public comment and open it up for public comment on items not on the agenda. So, and there you have 3 minutes.
You know what? We should move this back to center.
Is there somebody who can kind of move the podium over, please?
Lights, I can read it. My name is Tommy Ann Miller, and I live at 480 North Baldwin, and I would like to read the editorial as it appeared in Saturday's Star News, especially considering the situation in Sierra Madre, and I think it should be required reading for all city governments. The title is Limit Growth, Preserve Water. Don't blame the smelt. A district judge cited the danger of wiping out the tiny Sacramento Delta fish when he imposed tough restrictions that threatens Southern California's water supply. But if it hadn't been the smelt, it would have been something else. Eventually, something was going to arise to make the state face the fact that its water demands cannot keep up indefinitely while the water supply keeps shrinking. The preciousness of water in this semi-desert state is something that has escaped the attention of California's politicians. That's because all they can see is how growth replenishes public treasuries and provides more money to squander every year. State and local politicians routinely rubber stamp new developments with little thought to environmental preservation or the strain on the water supply. Something had to give. The expected result of the ruling last week is the threat of water rationing that would hit many Southern California communities hard. For most of us, it means adopting a perpetual drought mindset and conserving at every level. For agriculture, it will mean a hard economic punch, and for politicians, it ought to mean a serious rethinking of land use policy. Some will dismiss this as an overreaction to the possible extinction of a little-known fish. But concentrating on the water rights of smelt versus humans misses the entire point. We don't have unlimited amounts of water. If there isn't enough water for smelt or people, How can we continue to allow major construction developments that bring in more people who need more water and force more rationing on current residents? The answer is, we can't. The largest user of Delta Water, the Metropolitan Water District, has already made plans for rationing water to its 18 million users. No doubt every agency affected will do the same. The past of California has been one of opportunity and open horizons and the dream for millions of new and potential residents. This ruling makes it clear the future must be different for the state to continue to prosper. Water can be used more wisely, stronger conservation measures can be introduced, and future developments need to meet stringent land use planning rules and pay a hefty premium for that most basic of all necessities, water. Thank you.
Faye Angus, 405 North Cannon. The Star News editorial is very timely for Sierra Madre. Right now, our city is a prime example of water-guzzling construction. We're selling developers massive amounts of water while our city TV channel flashes that we are under a water rationing alert. Here are pictures of a tanker filling up from a city hydrant to wet down the dust from grading going on at the One Carter development. I understand that this is now owned by Lang Homes of the Dubai Investment Group. This past week, neighbors observed the tanker filling up as many as four times a day. Yesterday and today, the tanker continues to fill up from that hydrant. Susan Henderson reports that she was told by the site supervisor the tanker has a capacity of 4,000 gallons per load. That means the developers are tapping our water supply to the tune of 16,000 gallons per day, 80,000 gallons for the 5-day week. Multiply that by however many days or weeks they will continue to do this until the grading is done. For example, if it continues for 6 weeks, they will have used 480,000, close to 500,000 gallons of our water. All of this while residents are under a water rationing alert. No hosing down driveways, no watering between 10 a.m. and 4 p.m. If you use over your normal water consumption, the surcharge is heavy. If issued a warning, failure to comply and cut back could result in a temporary turnoff of your water service. In order to save a gallon here and there, we are urged to turn off the tap when brushing our teeth, when lathering up before we rinse off in a shower, etc. Are we doing all this so the city can sell developers 80,000 gallons of our water per week to lay down construction dust? Yes, I guess we are. This is an outrageous, discriminatory double standard. Ration the residents while selling developers an unlimited supply of city water for their construction. Due to the fact that residents are now on a water rationing alert, it is imperative that developers be immediately stopped from using our city water for this construction. Reclaimed water for our area is now available. I ask that the city enact an emergency ordinance or whatever it takes that only reclaimed water be used for all grading and construction citywide. Two hydrants providing reclaimed water are now available, recently became available within the last couple of weeks, for construction in our area. One is at the Whittier Narrows Water Reclamation Plant in El Monte, the other at the San Jose Creek Water Reclamation Plant, where the 605 and 60 freeways intersect. I'll give Bruce Inman the name and phone number of the person for contractors and construction companies to contact to arrange this. Talk about the greening of our town. This is an emergency water, and reclamation water is available.
I'll just comment that since this is not on the agenda for tonight, we can't really have a discussion, but at the end of the meeting when we set our agenda items, we can certainly consider agendizing this. Thank you.
Debbie Sheridan, 635 Valley Vista Drive. In a special report a few days ago, Dallas Rains, the weatherman on Channel 7, said that the drought is predicted to continue for several years. This is serious when it comes to the city's use and misuse of water. I am shocked at the huge volume of city water being used to settle the dirt due to grading at One Carter. They should be using recycled water. Some people may ask, if recycled water is used and it seeps down into the ground, could it pollute our water supply? The answer is no. Reclaimed water goes through intense purification and conforms to strict regulations. There is no way that any water reclamation plant would release water that would endanger a community's groundwater. Pomona uses reclaimed water extensively. It has its own city connection to reclaimed water. It is used for the golf course, parks, and of course, construction. The City of Industry likewise has its own connection to reclaimed water. Many high schools are now inquiring about the possibility of using reclaimed water for football fields, baseball diamonds, etc. On the use of city water for grading at One Carter, one person commented that the water taken from the hydrant is put back into city supplies as it seeps back down into groundwater. Well, so does the water that we use to water our lawns, trees, and landscape. By that argument, as the developer has been given access to unlimited city water with no restriction, so should we. We too are really not using up the water, we are putting it back into city supplies. If the developer can water the dust as much as he likes, well then all of us residents can water our gardens unrestricted with no surcharges as much as we like. How about that? Construction at One Carter could go on for a long time. We need to insist they, as well as all construction projects, use reclaimed water. Remember, the grading of the Stonehouse subdivision will be next. Another 80,000 gallons of city water per week, another possible 480,000 gallons to lay down the dust. It will happen unless we stop it now. The Star News editorial is right. California needs to, I quote, adopt a perpetual drought mindset and rethink its land use policies. This needs to begin right here in Sierra Madre, right now, as you had been talking about when you were in Sacramento. Now, rationing water is an emergency. We need an emergency ordinance mandating the use of reclaimed water for construction. And no more housing or condo developments. If we have to ration residents already here, we sure don't have enough water for more people to come into our community. Thank you very much.
Good evening. I'm Carol Parker, 368 Mariposa. This morning, another huge truckload of cut down trees was observed coming out of the One Carter development. This is heartbreaking for our community. Here are two pictures taken by neighbors on Carter Avenue. This first one is the beauty of the area before the bulldozing, and the second one is the picture of the trees that were cut down and it was scraped down to dirt. Paradise lost. This is the legacy you will be remembered for, Mayor Enid Jaffe and Councilman John Buchanan, and former council members Rob Stockley, Tonya Torres. The City Planning Commission unanimously voted to recommend that the City Council deny this configuration to the Carter subdivision and request that a new plan be submitted. The four of you decided not to follow their recommendation and voted approval of this project. Former Mayor George Maurer was the only City Council member who voted against approval of this plan, and he is on the record as trying to prevent the devastation that we now are all watching. And this is the only beginning of grading, cutting, and scraping. Here is a copy of my comments. Please make them, together with these pictures, a part of the documented minutes on the record of this meeting. Thank you.
I'd like to change the subject a little bit and make you laugh because you look kind of sad. And what they're doing up there is wrong. That's perfectly obvious. I know I raced in water when I quit. It's not a good thing to do what they did. And if you really had some backbone, you'd close that place up right now. And just with the public comment and the situation, you have probable cause. And let them come back into court, then the court will have to order it, because it just looks barren and stripped and fire safe. But still, you should close the place up. My change of subject is this. I'd like to announce, and I said I wasn't going to do it again, and I'd like to announce I'm going to run again in December. And also I'll go around and probably with Joe, and I'm going to recall Joe. We'll do it, Joe.
Leslie Hinton, 516 Acacia Street. This evening, I'd like to tell the city and the city council and anybody that's watching that the Rose Float for our city is going to have a Valentine's theme. And for that reason, instead of having just princesses, we're going to have two princesses and two escorts. The Rose Float Association will be accepting applications for the positions of princesses and escorts to represent the city at local functions and activities. The princesses and escorts not only will have the honor of riding on the float, they will have the pleasure of meeting with most of the city local government officials, service organizations, and clubs. In addition to assisting with the float decoration and publicity, the princesses will get to be in the, and the escorts will get to be in the 4th of July parade. They will be Santa's helpers at Dickens Village. The applicants must be 15 to 18 years old, have a 3.0 grade point average, and most of all, they have to be a resident of Sierra Madre. The applicants can pick up their applications at their local high school or at City Hall, or they can download them from the website. The applications must be mailed and received by the Sierra Madre Rose Float Association by October 10th, 2007. Applicants must appear for judging on the 13th of October, and no late applications will be accepted on the day of the tryouts. So here's a great opportunity this year for guys to be on the flow, as well as girls. A few years ago, my daughter was on it, and it was just a tremendous experience for her for the whole year. So I hope we have lots of applicants. And so if you know anybody, tell them to get their act together and apply. Thanks a lot.
Good evening. My name is Dave Ford. I'm the Public Affairs Regional Manager for Southern California Edison. And first, to the Mayor Jaffe and City Manager and Council members, first of all, I'd like to congratulate your city on receiving the All-American City Award. That's quite an accomplishment in itself. Also, I want to congratulate you for the milestone that you've achieved by this being a centennial year. So I was sitting there in the audience, it reflected on my younger days growing up in Kentucky, how the warmth of community like this is felt so much in a council chamber like this, where you're really able to connect with the community. I think it's vitally important that we as a community all across this country, a village raises a village. I want to just kind of share with you just for a minute or so the past experience over this last week or so, this horrific heat storm that affected pretty much all of Southern California. The impact on our system as well as the communities that we serve, part of our electrical system here in Southern California. Edison recognizes the inconvenience to customers of extended outages, and all available resources and contract crews were in the field working around the clock to restore service. As a matter of fact, I spent the entire Labor Day weekend, happened to be on duty, so I spent the entire weekend working around the clock, connecting with city officials and various communities, providing them up-to-date information about the outages. The first priority generally when a storm occurs of this nature is restoring power back to customers who have been without power the longest, such as a customer who might have been out of power for 36 hours, 24 hours, and so on. The impact on our system, we had several thousands of customers who were interrupted since the start of the heat storm, and during duration, several thousands, hundreds of circuits were interrupted, and we've replaced nearly close to 2,000 transformers during this storm. We had nearly 365 crews out working in various areas, and this storm pretty much was stemmed from Long Beach all the way to Santa Monica. From my experience that week, we did that during the storm, your community wasn't impacted as much as other communities. But our commitment to serve your community continues. In recent months, I have had the opportunity to work with public affairs and talk to your previous mayor, and recently had the opportunity to talk to the current mayor, and discussing how we can provide more updated information on Edison's programs and services that can help the city become more energy efficient, as well as talking to Michelle Keefe on programs that we can maybe co-promote with the city in helping residential customers become more energy efficient, being that help you save money and energy at the same time. We have quite a lot of programs that can be utilized via through our website, which is www.sce.com. There's a lot of residential programs as well as commercial programs, and upgrading lighting systems, pool pumps, refrigerator recycling, even in the commercial side on demand response. We are looking toward the future on how we can help customers become energy efficient. As the years approach, we will probably be more aggressively working toward installing a new metering system, which will be a smart meter that will be able to provide us intelligence to be able to convey to the customer on how to reduce energy more quickly and rapidly during peak times. I'm committed to helping your city and the community in working together to host workshops and seminars to make this educational process elementary, that energy efficiency is like a second nature. And I want to continue to commend your city and the efforts that you're doing to make this an all-American city. And I look forward to working with each and every one of you. Thank you.
Thank you.
Other community comment? Okay. Seeing none, we'll come back to the agenda. And the first action item on the agenda is the warrants. So,
Madam Mayor, I'm going to move ratification of resolution number 07-071, a resolution to approve payment of city warrants number 18255 through number 18300, number 18301 through number 18380, in the aggregate amount of $246,028.18. Sierra Madre Library warrants number 18384 through number 18386, number 18387 through number 18401, in the aggregate amount of $8,109.45. And payroll transfer in the aggregate amount of $509,057 for the fiscal year ending June 30th, 2007 and 2008. Do you want to take them motion by motion?
Let's go through it all because since we didn't have any meetings in August, we're playing catch up with the warrants.
It's not that
we spend twice as much money.
Madam Mayor, as part of that motion, I'd like to also move ratification of resolution 07-072, a resolution to approve payment of city warrants number 18250 through number 18254. Number 18402 through number 18403, 18404 through 18416, number 18417 through 18523, in the aggregate amount of $452,585.26. Sierra Madre Library warrants 18527, 18528 through 18551, in the aggregate amount of $8,109.45. And payroll transfer in the aggregate amount of $335,242.34 for the fiscal year ending June 30th, 2007 and 2008. Also part of that motion, I'd like to include approval of resolution 07-073, a resolution to approve city warrants number 18552 through 18559, number 18560 through 18580, in the aggregate amount of $65,522.74, and payroll transfer in the aggregate amount of $207,715.24 for the fiscal year ending June 30th, 2008.
All right. Yeah, Joe, if it doesn't work out here, you can always be an auctioneer.
Right.
Exactly.
And would anyone like to second it?
Second.
Okay. Any discussion?
Could you repeat that?
Oh, sure. One second.
Okay. All in favor say aye.
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 And I say aye, but I am abstaining on warrants 18364, 18498, and 18571. And I think all of those are Southern California Edison warrants. So I'm abstaining on them because that's my employer.
Okay. So motion carries.
Public comment.
He wants to talk.
Is there any public comment on the warrants? Would you like to make any public comment on the warrants? Come on up and do so.
We have way too much legal expense, the $120,000, and I'd like to know where it went, what it does, and if we're going to continue that. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. I think that's probably something that you could talk to the city manager about, and she can provide you with. You can talk to me. But to all of us. Yeah. Well, if the council decides, we can agendize it at a future meeting. It's definitely been something we've discussed about, but it's not agendized for tonight. Next is our consent calendar, and City Manager, would you care to read the consent calendar?
Yes, Mayor and City Council. Consent calendar at item 2A is a recommendation to receive and file the city's May 2007 to 11 2007 strategic goals and objectives, and I would like to just very briefly, the report is included in your agenda packet, but I'd just like to point out a few important milestones that have occurred in the last 3 months. The first one, the three-year goal was to achieve financial stability, and number one under that goal was to appoint the ad hoc Public Safety Finance Committee, and as you're aware, that committee is currently, they've been appointed, and they've already had 4 meetings, and their next meeting is this Thursday evening. So that is a goal where we're definitely on target. Under number two was the distribution of an RFP to conduct an economic study. That RFP was completed and put out for distribution. Responses have been received, and staff's currently in the process of reviewing those proposals. I'd also very quickly just want to go to the improving the infrastructure three-year goal. I believe it's probably number 8 or 9. It would be the completion of the CNG fueling station. I'd like to report that that item is currently out to bid, with bids being due the end of this month on September 27th. Improving internal and external communication. The council wanted the implementation of an employee appreciation week, which included a variety of activities, and that was held the first week in August. Under item number 7 is the City Council Commission and Boards, which Mayor Jaffe announced earlier this evening, to present the updated strategic plan and give input on our 5-year vision. And that meeting, as you announced, is scheduled for October 5th. And the last item I'd like to just announce would be the number 10 was to provide 2 state-mandated ethics workshops for members of the council, boards, and commissions. And those meetings have been scheduled. The first one on October 2nd, and the second one is on October 13th. Then, if there are no questions, item 2B would be a recommendation to approve the cooperative agreement between the County of Los Angeles and the City of Sierra Madre, and authorizing the mayor to execute the agreement on behalf of the city. For just quick background information, this will provide reimbursement for an outstanding receivable in the amount of $465,100 to reimburse the city for reconstruction of the Chantry Flats Road, Santa Anita Canyon Road. So the city will finally be receiving reimbursement for that item. Consent calendar item 2C is a recommendation to approve resolution 07-067, approving TUP 07-25 for the historic 5K walk on Saturday, October 20th from 8 a.m. to 10:30 a.m. This event is being sponsored by the Civic Club and is part of our centennial activities. And last would be item 2D, a recommendation to appoint Kathleen Driscoll to the Community Arts Commission due to an unscheduled vacancy. And that concludes my report.
Okay. Do we have any questions of staff on any of the items on the consent calendar?
I had one question, but yeah. I defer to
Mayor.
Well, that's okay. I was sort of looked left before I looked right, so okay. You go right ahead.
I'm just wondering, with respect to the appointments, recommendations to the different commissions, and in this case it's a community arts commission, we just have a recommendation, but there isn't any sort of evaluation done. So I'm just wondering about the process itself.
Hmm. If I could have Michelle Keith, our director.
I guess the problem I'm having is I'm just being asked in a vacuum to, and I have nothing whatsoever against Ms. Driscoll, but I'm just being asked in a vacuum to essentially rubber stamp a recommendation for a commission appointment, and that makes me uncomfortable.
Currently, the council's approved policy for commission appointments is as follows. Every commission is assigned a city council liaison. as well as most of the staff, commissions have a staff liaison and a chair of each commission. The current process, after we've gone through the posting of the MADI Act and provided out to the community that there's a 30-day or longer, in some cases, advertising of the vacancy, staff then receives applications from interested residents willing to serve on your various commissions. At that point, the chair of the commission of which there's a vacancy, so in this case it was the Arts Commission, the staff liaison, and the city council representative conduct an interview panel. And they ask all the applications the same interview questions, just like we do for a lot of our other personnel vacancies. At the conclusion of interviewing all the applicants, they have a discussion of who they think is the best fit with the existing commission or what they feel this person might give different and a gap that may be on a commission. And then that person's name is usually forwarded on to the city council for basically ratification. Sometimes we do give you the list of all the applicants. We tend to not give you too much information because we don't basically want what's the word I'm looking for? We don't put the whole applications in there because we don't want to violate people's privacy rights. Because the fact that they've applied for a commission is public record, but the personal information that's on the application is not. Does that help answer the question, Kurt?
Thank you.
Is there anything additional that you'd like to see? I didn't know we couldn't attach the application.
We had stopped doing that for that reason. And in this particular case, Mayor Jaffe is the liaison to the Arts Commission.
Right, and I did sit in on it, but I'm just asking kind of in general.
Yeah, I think in the future, on a going forward basis, I'd be a lot more comfortable when I'm being asked to vote yay or nay on a commission appointment if I could see some background information. And if you need to white out the personal information, I understand that, or it needs to be given to the council members, you know, as...
Do you want a list of all the applicants who applied and the subsequent backup information, or just on the person who's being recommended for appointment?
I'd like to see it all. So.
Okay. We can
so
do that.
So maybe just a paragraph, you know, so that we're not handing out their application, but just, you know, a little bit of information. I will comment that in this particular case, we had quite an impressive group of applicants, any one of whom we felt we could recommend. And in fact, we are inviting all of them to participate in other subcommittees and commissions. And
a good number of, in this case, are attending tomorrow night's Arts Commission meeting, in which they hope to look at the draft of the Cultural Arts Master Plan and start working on committees. So.
Right, because it was a very strong group, and that was good news. So,
yeah, but Kurt, you know, Kurt makes a point that I think has, you know, some merit here. We've been striking where this all originated is we had this balancing act. We used to have people come down here and do this interview at the podium, and that was awkward. And you then said yay or nay in front of them, and their applications were there, and then there became privacy issues and concern. So. But I think maybe we've gone a little bit so much the other way that we're, you know, we're putting on the consent calendar, and we've approved these a number of times over the last year. But I think maybe within a confidential white envelope, when we do get confidential information, you can put that background information at least for council review in case there is something that somebody sees. Most of the time, I don't think it'll end up making a difference, but it is. I think what we've done is we've gone the other way enough where we pushed it down so much to the commission that the rest of the council members are relying on the recommendations of three, and I suspect the recommendation is just fine here. In fact, I'm pretty sure it is, but maybe we could do that with an envelope, but that just maintains the confidentiality of the applicants.
The only issue is people get discouraged from applying on commissions if they are known to apply and they don't get on the commission. Mm-hmm. And so it's kind of a balancing act, and all you can really do, like for instance, Planning Commission, there right now is an opening on the Planning Commission, and which, by the way, we're looking for somebody. You have to have the people on the commission, or at least the head of the commission, look at that person, because they're going to be on that commission. Yeah. And it's always good to have a council person or persons part of that process. So that I think the process, it's kind of varied from year to year. Sometimes it's been a straight appointment by by mayor. Sometimes it's been, you know, very, very informal. And I think the idea of having a, the way it is working now is pretty good. But I think Kurt's right. If there is a choice that has to be made between two or three very, very close contenders, then I think it's a good idea as long as we can find a way to keep it confidential.
And I agree with you, it's a balancing act because we don't want to discourage the volunteers. We don't want somebody to feel that because they were not selected this time, that we're discouraging them from applying. And I know sometimes people feel, oh, well, I got rejected. I'm not going to do that again.
Right.
And that was why we wanted to make it clear in this particular case that all five people were very highly qualified and we'd love to see them in additional positions. And we actually asked that question in the interview and everybody said, yeah, definitely. And it's a great way to groom people to be on commissions too, because we need lots of volunteers. So yeah, I think John's right. It's that, you know, we kind of went, there was a point at which we were interviewing every person on every commission. There was one time, you know, back when the mayor appointed people, you know, we've tried different things to try to democratize it. And in general, I think this approach is good because it pushes it down to the level where it belongs, which is the actual commission. And but we can certainly, you know, like John said, we've gone a little too far in that direction. We have to come backwards so that it's not simply a rubber stamp. So, I did want to ask a question about the cooperative agreement. First of all, for anybody who doesn't remember, this has been a long story. You know, we got funding to do this 2004, 2005, did the work very promptly and then couldn't get paid thanks to, I won't even go into the machinations of Caltrans, but let us say that they backed out. You know, they made a commitment and said what we were doing was fine and then changed their minds. So I think the fact that, you know, we are getting this money is a real coup. And thanks to the hard work of Public Works Director Inman, who knows he kept getting phone calls from me saying, when are we going to get paid? When are we going to get paid? But I do have a question. It says in here that the money that would be the fund, the county fund that we're being paid from, is for road repairs, specifically street and road repairs, which of course is what we spent the money on. But does that mean that this money, because I know we're getting reimbursed, so does this money then have to be put toward road repairs?
Yes, it does mean that money does go towards road repairs. It will be coming back to the city in the form of county gas tax revenue. And gas tax, as you know, is restricted for use only in street maintenance, street repair, and associated work. So, yes, it will have to go to street maintenance.
So it can't give the police officers a...
No, this one's this okay, 400K isn't going to help in that area.
Yeah.
However, one of the things that I came away from the league meeting with is there are some Prop 1B monies that are partnership dollars, and I will be exploring using this $400,000 to possibly be the match and be able to get an extra $400,000 on top of that, provided that the state will allow us to use gas tax as the match. So okay. It could help us out significantly.
Okay, very good. So we might be halfway, you know, at least with this money, I know since we've already spent it, halfway toward being able to restart possibly our street program.
Correct, yes.
All right, other comments and questions?
Well, that's what my comment was going to be on. I'd like to echo, Bruce, what the mayor just said. It was a long battle to get that. And I think that I just wanted to thank the senator's office. Maybe we can send a letter to him for everything he's done. And also the Congressman Dreyer for the compromise here. The fact that we now have this money in the form of gas tax, and it's probably going to help us repave our roads. I think this is a huge coup for us, so thank you.
Same here.
It's all you, Bruce.
And John did show up to the meeting at the governor's office in L.A. to press the case for getting this money.
Well, this has been going on for
mayor.
7 years, I think.
It's been a long haul.
This solution was worked out with, actually, Caltrans caused a lot of problems, but this solution was actually worked out with them, too. And so it was an ingenious way of dealing with an issue that we never should have had to deal with. And I'm glad we have this money, and I'm glad we have that. If we can roll it together with the Prop 1B money that comes in, we can deal with one of those unfunded obligations that we have. Now, mind you, the streets that we need to still do probably are going to cost us, what was it, $3 million or something like that. So this is about, yeah, well, whatever it was depending on which form of financing we did. So this is only about maybe $700,000, $800,000 when you roll the two together, but it's better than where we are now. So,
Bruce, one question just came to mind. What about the end part of that compromise about something we had to support for the county? Is there any kind of, can you kind of give us a prediction as to the future, what we have to support and what they're going to ask for?
What's the quid pro quo?
Yeah.
Actually, the quid pro quo is pretty innocuous in this instance. And basically, Caltrans is giving the county $465,000 out of their discretionary funds.
Right.
The county will use that on a joint Caltrans-county project.
Right.
In return, the county gives us the $465,000 out of their revenue. What Caltrans has asked for to make them whole is for the city to support Caltrans getting an earmark of $465,000 from some federal source. All we have to do is basically write
a letter.
Send a letter. Send a letter.
All right.
So
we'll do it.
We can probably scrape one of those together.
All right. Thanks. Thank you.
So what happened to the $465,000 that we did have earmarked? Does that just go into the ether?
No, that went back into the federal pot.
It was not only earmarked, it was authorized and appropriated.
Yeah.
And was at the state level and then stopped at Caltrans.
Right. Federal Highway Administration took it back.
Yeah.
Okay. Don't go away. I have one other question, and this is on the actually on the strategic goals. The pool pump. I know we're kind of holding on that because of money, but can you just explain the nexus between the pool pump and the heater and why we can't do it and what happened? And I noticed there's like a AQMD fine, and does that have anything to do with this?
I'm going to have to defer to Michelle on that one.
The situation right now is that we have the second pump, and it's been repaired and ready to be installed. But its installation requires us to drill a core hole into the surge pit of the back of the pool house. And reorganize the back of the pump house, which is with our two large chemical tanks and the heater. But before we moved the heater, we had applied for a grant with the AQMD 18 months ago through an alternative source funding program. And although it was hand-delivered by our city manager at the time to the AQMD, they lost our application. And we have been since waiting on them to reappropriate the funds, and we call about once every month to find out when the program's going to start again. We were just called 2 weeks ago to say that they had a meeting and that they were likely to release new results in the next 3 to 4 weeks. And according to them, because they've already looked at our application, it's still in perfect condition to submit it in order to get the money for the new heater. And the reason why we've waited to get the pool pump in has everything to do with we just don't want to do all that work and then not have the right space for the new heater because it requires some reconfiguration of large pieces of equipment in the back of the pool house.
Okay. So we're not paying a fine because of noncompliance?
Absolutely not.
Okay, good. And this is, if it's already going to happen, then it's probably not necessary, but this is exactly the kind of thing that Antonovich's air quality deputy is wonderful at expediting. So Debbie Mendelson, this is the kind of thing she'll go and sort of shake in the face of the executive officer and say, here, do this for Mike. So
I will let you know if we need
yeah.
help.
Okay, great, thanks. All right, other comments, questions? Any comments from the audience on any of the items in the consent calendar?
Just one little item here that I would like a little explanation for. It says on page 2 of 2 of the cooperative agreement report, The appeal was denied. It was mentioned that this was held up for so long, with the federal agency holding that the city had violated federal bidding and award regulations. What was that all about?
Well, in my comments, remember I mentioned that Caltrans went back on their word, and I can let Bruce elaborate, but my recollection, because I was kind of in and out of this at the time, was that we had checked the language of our bid documents with Caltrans at the time that they were released, and we have in writing that they were fine. And then after the fact, after we had done all the work, you know, done the contract, done all the work, they came back and said, oh, well, you tried to negotiate with your successful bidder. And we went back to the original language and discussion and pointed out we did not negotiate. We had an option to reduce the scope of work. We did to fit the budget. And Bruce, correct me if I'm wrong here. And they basically told us that that was fine. And then they turned around and told the feds not to pay us. So that's in a nutshell. It was months and months. But we did not do anything wrong, in my opinion. They agreed, and we had it in writing, that we were fine. They reneged. I've seen them do this before and since. And, you know, how do you argue? You know, when they've already basically told you that they're recommending it for payment, and then turns out months later we found out that they had not recommended it for
payment. I understand. I remember the incident well. It was that disaster where they took 800 truckloads of mud away from there.
Right.
And I believe we shared some of the expense with the city of Arcadia.
Correct.
And I presume that Arcadia has received their reimbursement.
I don't know. That's equitable. A good question. We did our work first. It was sort of in two chunks, and we did ours first.
When we paid, did we pay for that? And what fund did it come out of if we paid for it? If we didn't pay for it, how did that all work?
Do you want to respond, Bruce? Now you're beyond my area of expertise.
No, I understand.
There have been a series of problems with Arcadia's section of Chantry Road. There have been at least three sections that have had problems. First was the incident where we shared some of the damage in February of 2000. The expenses that the city incurred at that time were primarily for the delivery and installation of the K-rail along the edge of the roadway that still remains there today. That was installed to keep the mud in the street and keep it from going over the edge of the road and down into private property. That money came from general fund reserves at that point. The city manager at the time, with the blessing of the council, declared a state of emergency. That was not picked up by the county, and therefore there was no way for the city to get reimbursed for that.
But we were obligated to do it.
But we were obligated to do it, exactly. Arcadia has since had two other sections of the road collapse due to rainfall and flooding. I'm not sure what the status is of their reimbursements, but I do know that they've gotten outside help from FEMA and other agencies on their sections. There's one last section of road in the city of Monrovia's jurisdiction that they're still trying to get money for to correct.
Yeah. And I know every year we have a breakfast with Supervisor Antonovich, and we politely ask him if he'd like to take his road back. So, because basically we're responsible for it, but you know, you can see the problems it generates, you know, in having to fix it.
There actually is a verbal agreement in place under which the county is going to take that road back. They're simply waiting for Monrovia to fix that one last section of road. They want it to be the road to be in good shape before they take it back.
Of course.
Can we make that verbal agreement in writing pretty soon?
Yeah.
You might know that
how
we're
much
a little
is the cost to fix
we're, we're a little antsy about taking people's word for it these days.
Okay,
on,
we're still doing
stuff.
Public comment on consent items, right?
Yeah, thanks. Barbara Lee, 425 Eastern Madre Boulevard. It's combined with that, since the county does use the fire department, I'm sure there's loopholes in getting the money from the county. But regarding roads, if I can also ask an addendum to when you do the agenda for the water rights on Carter, city water rights, to add also any infrastructure that will be destroyed with the heavy trucks moving the water up to
Carter One and Stonehouse, that that be included also.
Okay, so any other public comment on the consent calendar? All right. I haven't yet asked for a motion and second on the consent calendar, so why don't I do, didn't?
I'll move the consent calendar.
I haven't yet asked for it.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay, so motion, you move?
I'll move the consent calendar.
Second.
Okay. Moved and seconded. Any further discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Okay, motion carries. All right. Item number three, Madam Sitting, would you want to do 5 minute break? Let's go ahead and take a quick 5 minute break right now, and we'll be right back with item three.